to you by Penguin.
Your Journey, Your Way. How to Make the Mental Health System Work for You. Written and read by me, Horatio Clare. Disclaimer. The information in this audiobook has been compiled as general guidance on specific subjects addressed. It is not a substitute and not to be relied on for medical, healthcare, or pharmaceutical professional advice. Please consult your GP before changing, stopping, or starting any medical treatment. So far as the author is aware, the information given is correct and up to date as at January 2024. Practice, laws, and regulations all change, and the listener should obtain up-to-date professional advice on any such issues. The author and publishers disclaim, as far as the law allows, any liability arising directly or indirectly from the use or misuse of the information contained in this book. Having said all of which, this audiobook is for you, dear listener, in belief and solidarity. Introduction. This book is for anyone who suffers from mental health troubles and for anyone who cares for someone who does. Whether your interest is in anxiety or psychosis, clinical depression, insomnia, self-harm, an eating disorder, or any one of many conditions of the mind and brain which can be hell to endure and hell to witness, you find yourself at a fascinating and dicey moment in how we understand and treat mental health. The good news is there is no condition from which we suffer which cannot be helped to some degree, great or small. There are effective treatments, some novel, some established, and many just coming into practice, for pretty well everything. Every sufferer, indeed every human being, is on a spectrum which runs from very mentally ill to perfectly mentally well, and we do know how to move people along these paths, perhaps a short way, perhaps a significant distance, in a positive direction. The bad news is that a great many of us, perhaps most of us, do not know which treatments will best suit us, and many of us cannot access the care and support we need. There is a vast amount of information and advice available, but unless you are a specialist professional, it can be impossible to know what is accurate, what is relevant, and what applies to you. A great deal of what you will find on the internet is outdated, confusing, or simply wrong. This book is a guide to the latest developments in the understanding and treatment of mental health. It explains how to go about helping yourself or someone close to you whom you are worried about. It is journalistic in that it is accurate, unbiased, and has no agenda beyond public service. It explains how mental health treatment models can work and how they fail, examining their assumptions and mechanisms. And it is written in the certain knowledge that accurate and up-to-date ways of seeing and understanding and treating mental health can really, truly help. For example, should you read this book before you next meet a doctor, psychiatrist, or social worker, you will know something of how they think about you and your condition, what their options are, and how they make their decisions. If you find, having read it, that you know more about what can and might work for you than they do, that should not be surprising. Most practitioners will not know the nuances and specifics of your unique individual condition as well as you do. Most practitioners do not have the time to keep abreast of all the developments in an enormously wide field which spans psychiatry and psychology. Most practitioners do not have access to the leading and most expert researchers and clinicians whose insights and recommendations are the meat of this book. Most of us find ourselves caught somewhere between whatever services our local NHS trust can provide, which can be good, or patchy, or inconsistent, or plain inadequate, whatever support we might be able to pay for, i.e. going to a private therapist, assuming one is available, and assuming we can afford one, which many of us cannot, and the infinite uncertainties of whatever we might find on the internet. This is a hard enough place to be for those of us who are well, and perhaps looking to help and support someone close to us. And it is a truly horrible place to be if you are the one who is suffering. I have been in both of these positions, and to some degree I always will be. I have a mental health condition which needs managing, and I am engaged in trying to help others. At the end of 2018, I had a breakdown. I was fully psychotically delusional, believing I was helping the security services and aliens to bring about world peace, and engaged to Kylie Minogue. In the service of world peace, I deliberately wrote my car off and started gouging holes in the ceilings of my flat. I was detained under Section 2 of the Mental Health Act and confined to a ward in a psychiatric hospital for a couple of weeks. When I came out, terrified by a choice between a lifetime on medication and a lifetime of worsening madness, I spent days and weeks trawling the internet and books for information and solutions. Much of what I found was contradicted by other findings. Much turned out to be unsubstantiated. Much was simply wrong. My journalistic interest was piqued. Over weeks and months, my sense of self, my confidence, and my powers of research and analysis began to return. I talked to sufferers, families, experts, researchers, practitioners, and outliers from across the fields of psychiatry, psychopharmacology, therapy, and general medicine, and I found myself, as a journalist, in the middle of what seemed to me a huge and important news story. A story with critical implications for the 1 in 4 of us who struggle with our mental health, and for all of those who love and worry about us. For example, did you know that psychiatrists and psychologists are in fundamental disagreement about the causes and best treatments for mental illness? I didn't. Did you know that they even dispute the causes of mental illness? Whole branches of psychiatry assume mental illness has biomedical roots and solutions, the idea that there is something wrong with your brain chemistry. Although neuroscience has yet to find biomarkers in the body or brain which would prove that mental illness is a physical or chemical condition, psychiatry has met much success, and also much failure, by treating people as if the biomedical hypothesis was proved, by prescribing chemicals. Meanwhile, whole areas of psychology believe the questions and answers to mental distress do not lie in physical brain deformities or in the balance of chemicals in the brain. Psychology believes that the troubles and the answers most often lie in the sufferer's context, i.e., in your life history and personal circumstances. Psychiatry points to the huge numbers of people who have been helped, even saved, by psychiatric medication. Psychology and critics of psychiatry, including many sufferers and their families, point to the huge numbers of people who have not been helped by psychiatric drugs and those who have suffered for taking them. I was amazed to find that psychiatry and psychology do not even agree on the language and terminology of mental health. Psychiatry talks about mental illness and about disorders. Psychology talks about distress and sufferers. Many psychiatrists, and certainly two of the three who have treated me, assume that disorders are located in the brain. The other one was French. She saw my situation differently and had very different solutions to it. Many psychologists see childhood and life events as the place to look for and address the problem. How, I wondered, are we going to solve or salve mental illness and suffering if we cannot agree where it comes from, what to call it, or how to treat it? Like many people who know what they want to find, for me, a third way, a way out of the crushing binary choice of long-term drugs or madness, I set about looking for it in ways which seemed most likely to deliver it. I read much more literature from the anti-psychiatry side of the debate than from the pro-psychiatry side, and listened carefully to those, including many psychiatrists, who question or condemn the way things are now. This was partly defiance and partly panic. I was under heavy pressure to accept the diagnosis two psychiatrists had given me, bipolar, and to take lithium or aripiprazole or another antipsychotic for years, perhaps for life. I was not looking for the most effective way out, necessarily. I was looking for a way of being sane while not taking long-term drugs, for a way of being normal or at least balanced in ways the bipolar diagnosis did not seem to offer unless I took the drugs. It turns out, as I found, that there is no basic right or wrong with psychiatric drugs. They can do enormous, life-saving good, and they can do great harm. What you really need, and what you are most unlikely to get, is deep specialist knowledge of how you might best move forward according to the most up-to-date thinking in understanding your condition, in the use of psychiatric drugs, in actions you can take, in therapy, and in recovery pathways. You will find that knowledge and that thinking here. After years of research and asking questions, I found ways forward for me, and I found that they exist to a greater or lesser extent for all of us. I do not mean we can all be healed, or that we can all reach a place.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.